Hello, welcome back to the end of the world as we know it. I feel fine. I'm your professor, Dr. Kovach. Well, last time I told you that there are four positions regarding the relation between philosophy and religious belief. What are they? I'll tell you them again. Position number one, positivism. The positivists believe there's only two kinds of meaningful statements. Logical truths, like 7 plus 3 equals 10, and those statements that you could describe how you would find out if they were true using your five senses. Well, there's no positivists anymore. Why not? Again, because consider the claim that there's only two kinds of meaningful truths. Only two kinds of meaningful statements, logical truths and those that can be verified. Hey, is that claim a logical truth? I don't think so. Is that claim something you can verify using your five senses? Well, what does meaningful smell like? What does meaningful sound like? What does meaningful look like? I can't tell you if a statement's meaningful or not using my five senses. So, that's why positivism died. Position number two was the Wittgensteinian position. That's too complicated for a freshman course. I would have to take a whole semester teasing out all the details of Wittgensteinian philosophy of religion. You know, it's just the idea that the philosopher's job is to understand what the religious language game is about. And position number three, that we went into some detail last time with people like Clifford, was that it's wrong always, everywhere for anyone to believe anything upon insufficient evidence. So, they claim religious beliefs are stupid. Last position, some religious beliefs are reasonable even when you have no conclusive evidence. And you know who champions a view like this? That's right, my main man, Thomas Aquinas. He's a guy who likes this kind of view. More on that in a moment. Sorry if you think I just called you a moron. That's not what I was saying. So, think of it this way. I asked you at the end of the last lecture to think what would constitute evidence for a religious claim. And would that criterion, that standard of evidence, be applicable to all of your beliefs? You want to know what I believe? I really believe this, call me crazy. I believe the world is more than 15 minutes old. Yeah, I believe that. I believe the world is more than 15 minutes old. I don't have any evidence though. And you say to me, but surely your memory constitutes evidence. Nah, see, suppose you told me that you believe that the universe popped into existence 15 minutes ago, complete with people having pseudo-memories, that's different from an actual memory, pseudo-memories of things happening years and years ago. 15 minutes ago, the universe popped into existence just like we find it. And you say, well, what about carbon dating? I say, no, again, the universe popped into existence 15 minutes ago with things having features such that you would think they existed longer, but no, that's just how they popped in. That's just the way they popped into being. I don't know how to prove that that's wrong. I don't have a shred of evidence, of conclusive evidence against that. If you tell me that is your belief, that the world popped into existence 15 minutes ago, I think you're a lunatic. I think you need to go talk to a doctor. First of all, I'll say, why not 18 minutes ago? You say, no, 15 minutes ago. Why not 24 minutes ago? Look, I told you, that's not what I believe. I believe it began 15 minutes ago. Look, if you believe that, you're weird. Equally weird is the demand for evidence that the world existed 15 minutes ago, more than 15 minutes ago. I believe my parents loved me. Evidence? What's the evidence for that? No, I mean, they didn't torture me. That's a pretty low bar. That's a pretty low bar for love, not torturing me. Lots of people don't torture me, but I don't believe they love me like my parents loved me. Sorry, I'm just coughing. Just a little cough. I don't have coronavirus. You can't get coronavirus from watching YouTube videos. Don't worry. I believe I probably don't have coronavirus. Evidence? I haven't taken the test. So we have all these beliefs. I believe Abraham Lincoln was shot in a theater by John Wilkes Booth. You know why I believe that? Because people told me. People told me to believe that. I didn't see it. I wasn't there. Oh, well, the people who told me were there. No. The people who told me weren't there. Oh, but I mean, they're close friends. No. They're, you know, how many degrees away from am I from someone who actually saw Abe Lincoln get shot? First of all, only a few people saw it, even though it was in a theater. Relatively few people saw it. How many people do you think were in that theater? Then they told someone who told someone who told a newspaper reporter. And then my great-great-grandparents, their parents, read the newspaper article. And they told their kids. Their kids grew up to tell someone who became a school teacher. And the school teacher told someone, you see what I'm getting at here? Look how far away I am from anyone who actually saw Abe Lincoln get shot by John Wilkes Booth. And yet, I believe it. I believe it happened. You better believe I believe it. Don't accuse me of being some conspiracy theorist about Lincoln's assassination. I don't think there was some second gunman on the grassy knoll for Abraham Lincoln. No. See, These strike me as completely legitimate beliefs. And yet it's, where's the evidence? Where is the evidence? Well, it goes back to the question part of what constitutes evidence. In the case of Abe Lincoln, you might look at what philosophers call the simplest explanation. What's the simplest explanation for the fact that school teachers tell us that John Wilkes Booth shot Abraham Lincoln? Well, the simplest explanation is that it happened, people saw it, it got reported to legitimate newspapers, and that there's a reliable line of transmission for that information right down to the present day. I can't think of a simpler explanation. And if you say to me, I think I know why teachers are teaching that, and you go into some conspiracy about how there's a war in higher education, some of us are very anti-seating furniture, like booths, and very pro-car, like a Lincoln. And therefore, we have to have a war to see who's the bad guy, who's the good guy in Abraham Lincoln versus John Wilkes Booth. And it so happens the pro-car people are beating the pro-seating furniture people. This is insane! Nobody thinks that way. Okay, that's not the simplest explanation at all. Philosophers have a fancy word for that. Called Occam's razor. Occam's razor, all else being equal, prefer the simplest explanation. I'm not going to ask you about Occam's razor on a test. I'm just going to tell you. It's the kind of term that you can drop at a fancy party. Everyone's going to think you're very smart. They're going to say, oh, you're so smart. Let us get you another gin and tonic. So yeah, think about Occam's razor. You can look it up, figure it out for yourself. I'm here to talk about Aquinas on faith and reason. How do they go along? Can faith and reason get along? Aquinas certainly thinks so. Aquinas is sometimes hailed as the paradigmatic thinker of reconciling faith and reason. The reading I gave you from today is from the very first page of his master work called Summa Theologiae. And he's asking whether faith can be reasonable. You can reread this passage through that lens. Can faith be reasonable? And when you read this passage, remember the structure that Aquinas wrote in. Remember, he considers objections, then he gives an argument, then he responds to the objections. So this is a very short reading. I think it's under one page if I sent it to you. One page, maybe a page and a paragraph. You can reread it, and reread it in light of what I'm about to tell you about Aquinas on faith and reason. Okay, Aquinas thinks this. There are two categories of religious beliefs. There'll be on a handout that I should send you via the email, but I'll put them on the board too, just like we're in a real class again. See, isn't this nostalgia? Doesn't this take you back to happier times, seeing your beloved teacher right on the board? Okay, here's the two beliefs that Aquinas had, the two categories of beliefs that Aquinas thinks we can have regarding faith and reason, regarding religious truths. There are beliefs knowable just by thinking hard. He talks about science in the text, right? Scientific thinking. Aquinas thinks we can discover certain things about God. And you say, but what is God? I'll get there. That's the next lecture. Don't worry about that yet. We're just setting the grounds here. There's some religious things we can figure out by thinking really hard. Like that God exists. Like that God is not a person. There's all kinds of negations we can make about God, thinks Aquinas. God is not a fish. God knows everything. All these things Aquinas thinks you don't have to read the Bible to figure out, or the Quran, or the Bhagavad Gita, none of that. Sure, again, that's just a cough. Don't worry. You can't get coronavirus from an internet video. I already told you that. You should have paid attention the first time. These things we can know about God, just by thinking hard. You might also discover it by reading the Bible. Why, says Aquinas? Why this redundancy in the system? This redundancy in the system is for our benefit. You see, figuring out what's called, and this has a name, by the way, this is called natural theology. Natural theology, or philosophical theology. Natural, what's natural means not supernatural. We're going to get to the supernatural stuff in a minute. Right now we're just doing the natural stuff. Okay, here's the thing. It's really hard work. These next few weeks with me, when we're doing philosophical theology, I'm going to tax your brain. I'm going to make you think harder than you've ever thought before. This stuff is like calculus, but philosophical calculus, right? It's going to take your mind right up to its limits. And let's be honest, you're able to do it. You got into Loyola Marymount University. You're able to do it. Some people can't do it. Some people might find this video and discover that when they go to the next video, the one after that, that that's just too much for them. It takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of time. You're in such a wonderful place in your life. For the next few years, a lot of you are freshmen, you've got 4 years. If you're a sophomore, you've got a couple more. You get to think for a good part of your day gets to be spent learning beautiful things about philosophy. It takes time to learn philosophy. If you're working 14 hours a day, if you're working two jobs, raising a family, go home at night, you don't want to read Aquinas. I understand. You want to watch the Netflix, have a cold beer. I used to work as a boiler technician in Northeast Cleveland, Ohio. Long days, get dirty, sweat a lot, go home. I was just exhausted. I kept saying to myself, I kept making these resolutions, I'm going to go home and read Plato. You know, if I had a real easy day, sometimes I had an easy day, I could go home and read Plato. But most days, you know what I finally did? That's when I finally made a resolution I could keep. I was going to watch every Star Trek, every episode, every movie. That was my accomplishment. It took 3 years. Well, that's how life goes when you work a lot of hours doing hard manual labor. I wasn't going to learn natural theology. Why else is natural theology difficult for some people? They got to be really smart, they got to have a lot of time, they got to be able to put in the effort. You know, some people just don't want to, some people have other interests. Some people like to study chess. That's what they do. Everybody should have some intellectual stimulation. Everyone can find time for some intellectual stimulation. It might be playing an instrument. It might be playing chess. It might be reading great poetry. It might be reading philosophers. You can keep reading philosophers after school. You can read a Platonic dialogue a year. But not everyone's going to be inclined to really put in the time and the effort for natural theology. So, says Aquinas, lucky us, lucky us. God has given us a shortcut and what we now call supernatural theology or revealed theology. Knowledge given directly by God. Aquinas calls that revealed theology. He calls it sacred doctrina, sacred teaching. Sometimes he calls it just theology. We're going to call it revealed theology, okay? You mind if I just give it a label? Just keep up. Okay. This lecture today, you got to understand one thing. You only got to walk out of here today with one thing. You got to understand clearly that Aquinas believes both of these are legitimate approaches to God. And this category, and this is the other reason he thinks it's necessary, this category includes stuff you're never going to get this way. Everything over here, thinks Aquinas, you can get from here. Not everything from here, you can get from here. For Aquinas, here's some examples. Jesus was born of a virgin. No matter how hard you think, you know, you go off with your notebook and you start doing the calculations, you're never going to get that. That's never going to occur to you. You can only get that if you have, oh, remember this word, faith? How did we describe faith? Remember how we described it? Believing God. You're only going to get knowledge that Jesus was born of a virgin if you believe what's written in the New Testament. That a human being was born with two natures, two essences, you just got the one essence. Remember we talked about essence. Essence answers the what is it question. Go back to your notes if you don't remember that. You have one essence, humanity. Aquinas thinks Jesus had two essences, humanity and divinity. What's divinity? I'll tell you in a lecture or two. Stop getting ahead. God is three subsistent relations. Don't even worry about what that language means. So the doctrine of the Trinity for Christians. You're never going to figure it out by thinking really hard. You can't do any kind of real rigorous thought experiment and realize, oh, the creator of the universe is actually three. You're only going to get that by having faith. Well, you might say, why isn't faith stupid? Clifford said it's wrong always, everywhere, and for everyone to believe upon insufficient evidence. And you're saying that there's no sufficient evidence, there's no conclusive evidence that Jesus was born of a virgin. There's no conclusive evidence that Jesus rose from the dead 3 days after being crucified. So why is religious beliefs, why is it reasonable to have these beliefs even without conclusive evidence? And Aquinas' answer here is going to be that it's not unreasonable. He's never going to give you the knockdown argument that Jesus rose from the dead. What's a knockdown argument? Look, I can give you a knockdown argument. You may have seen me do this before. I can give you a knockdown argument that 0.999 repeating is identical to the number 1. I can give you a knockdown argument. How's it go? It goes like this. What's 1/3 converted to decimal? You say 0.3 repeating. I say, what's 1/3 times 3? You say 1. But I say, what's 0.3 repeating times 3? You say 0.9 repeating. Well, if 1/3 times 3 equals 1, and 1/3 in decimal is 0.3 repeating, then 0.3 repeating times 3 should be 1. Knockdown argument. Replay the tape if you need to go slower. You know, on YouTube, you can change the playback speed. Oh, yeah. Oh, life hacks are getting in this class. Thanks to the coronavirus. That's a knockdown argument. You don't get to disagree with me when I say 0.9 repeating equals 1. You say, well, I don't know. Is there really enough evidence? Look, that's a knockdown argument. Where's the knockdown argument that Jesus rose from the dead? Don't got one. What do we have? We have a coherent story that's not unreasonable. What is the coherent story for Aquinas? It goes something like this. What is the likelihood that a small group of people would devote themselves to a message that's frankly insane? How insane is it? Well, this is the message of Christianity, that if you don't love other people, you're dead. But if you do, they'll kill you. If you don't love other people, you're dead, and if you do, they'll kill you. At some point, about 2,000 years ago, a small group of people decided to dedicate themselves to that message. And they really upset the authorities, the people with power, the oppressing class, the rulers. And sure enough, they started getting themselves killed. I mean, becoming a Christian was just a deadly thing to do. To claim that Jesus rose from the dead, to proclaim this message of absolute love for everyone, that's insane. You don't do that. You know, I mean, the message was this. You have to stop trying to become rich. You want to be rich? You can't be a Christian. If that's your goal, is to become a rich person, forget about Christianity. It's not the religion for you. You have to embrace a kind of simplicity, a kind of poverty. I don't mean squalor. Squalor is different from poverty. I mean that I can't want things I don't need. I can't want to have a fancier car just so I can impress people I have no right to impress. Right? Christianity, Aquinas says, asks us to give up some very natural, basic human ambition. And not only were people willing to get on this movement, they were willing to get themselves tortured for it, and Christianity becomes the biggest religion in the world. Still is. Well, is it? I don't know. statistically, most people identify as Christians, but then again, look who the president is. Even in this country where most people identify as Christians. But it became a really big deal, Christianity. What are the odds? What are the odds that this insane message was embraced by people who were deliberately lying? What is the odds that people were willing to get tortured for a lie at the time that Christianity was founded? So Aquinas says, look, do I have a knockdown evidence? Do I have a knockdown argument that Jesus was raised from the dead? No. But I can show that everything in this category, says Aquinas. Aquinas thinks this. Everything in this category can be shown to be not unreasonable. Believing that the reason these early Christians were willing to get tortured just for the right to give up their ambitions to be rich was based on something that they've actually witnessed, believing that, that seems reasonable. I don't think you're a lunatic if you believe that. You see, if you tell me, if you come into my office hours, hey, Zoom office hours happening soon. If you come into my office hours and tell me that you believe June 9th, 1928, a group of vampires from outer space landed in Greensburg, Pennsylvania, and had a small banquet and then left. That's what you tell me you believe. Well, I don't think that's reasonable. I see no reason to think that's reasonable. It's downright unreasonable to just have that belief just in a vacuum, just in a vacuum. Well, Aquinas is trying to say, look, this stuff isn't handed on in a vacuum. It's not handed on just out of nowhere, right? There's a story that makes it kind of plausible. I don't want to say probable, but it makes it, you know, the kind of thing that is certainly, I can believe it. I can believe it. Okay. I've been using that word a lot, that G word, God. Remember? Remember when I told you about Aquinas? Little kid, like the first story we have about him. He says to his teacher, Big Al, he says, excuse me, you keep using that word, God, you gonna tell us what it means? And if you recall, I told you, Aquinas never claimed to come to an answer. Aquinas happily died unable to answer that question. And yet I keep using it. So I've told you that there's this theory of the categories. What's the theory of the categories? You know what something is when you know the rules for talking about it. We're going to see Aquinas thinks that theory of the categories doesn't quite work for God, but nevertheless, we've got to figure out what it is we're saying here, all these God statements. What is God? What does it mean to talk about God? That's the topic for next time. Keep reading. Read the next reading, I believe, is question 2, article 2. This one was question 1, article 1. I may have not have labeled the readings with those, but just so you know where we are, we're going to keep talking about Aquinas. Next topic is, what does it mean to say that God exists? Hope you're all doing well. See you later.